Do we really have to hang out in a cave and build a backstory, a plausible backstory for how we managed to realize now? Do we need a backstory? Does now need a backstory? We need to say, oh yeah, now I spent 30 years meditating in a cave, and that's how I came to know you. Sometimes you read a book, you may come across something, you're searching for an answer, and one word, or just pow, that's what happened to me tonight. Open up A Course in Miracles. I was reading about teachers, and it came down to something, and it said, I can't remember what it said, doesn't even matter, but it was something. I just stopped, put the book down like that, and said, wow, that's it. It wasn't even along the lines of what the writing was about, actually, but it triggered something, it clicked. And along the lines of, now, when you're awake to true nature, everything, the whole world's wonderful. Everything is simple, is easy, is wonderful. That's what Jesus says. And then I was thinking, yeah, that's great. I mean, but I want to know how to be enlightened when the world's difficult, under difficult circumstances. And then I said, whoa, wait a minute. When you're enlightened, there are no difficult circumstances. And I'm saying, I want to be enlightened under difficult circumstances, to be able to function under, you know, an enlightened way under difficult circumstances. And then I realized there are no difficult circumstances. So this is really interesting. And then I realized my whole life has been wasted. Absolutely. I said, just stop right there. It's okay. Don't struggle with it. What I've been trying to do is develop super difficult circumstances for myself so that when I'm enlightened, I will, hopefully that will like carry over, you know, and then I'll still be able to figure out how to get rid of difficult circumstances. Wow, what a trick I've played on myself. But when you're enlightened, there are no difficult circumstances. It doesn't matter what condition you're in, what difficulties you're in. There's everything, everything is completely taken care of by the grace of God. There are no difficult circumstances. So wasted time, right? We totally wasted time trying to, I was thinking like, if I could just, you know, understand, be able to explain to people, how does enlightenment, how can you function when the times are difficult? What good is enlightenment for you when times are difficult? It's a trick question. With enlightenment, times are never difficult. There is no difficulty. So this was just like an epiphany of recognition. I said, uh-oh. Obviously, we have a situation. As long as we want to figure out how to deal with different difficult circumstances, we will never be enlightened. Okay, as long as we're trying to figure out how to deal with difficult circumstances, we will never be enlightened. And when we're enlightened, there are no difficult circumstances. See, this is really tremendous. Yeah. This is like a wow Wow. And just full stop. I just full stopped it and just, okay. This is deserving a full stop, right? As long as we want to figure out how to deal with difficult circumstances, we will not be enlightened. As soon as we're enlightened, there are no difficult circumstances. We're not protecting any backstory. There's no backstory that has to be protected. But even more than that, let's just put it, no difficult circumstances at all. The ego's trying to teach us how to deal with difficult circumstances, right? And the Holy Spirit's telling us just be enlightened, accept where you are, which is now, and there are no difficult circumstances. So the purpose of this video is to just share how does one manage when one has like this fundamental epiphany. Well, full stop in the now, just okay. Didn't try to grasp it or get a hold of it or frame it, put it on a wall, certificate, you know. No, just okay. This is glad that this recognition is here now. Just sort of like that. Okay, come on in. Go about your business. The visitor has arrived. Come on in, and just let them settle in. As long as we want to figure out, to strive, to try to deal with difficult circumstances, we will not be enlightened. As soon as we choose to be enlightened, there are no more difficult circumstances. That's the quandary. And the thing is, we've worked so hard to get difficult circumstances, you know. I've put a massive effort into it, apparently, to put myself, you know, through extremely difficult circumstances. Must have taken a lot of effort in planning. And now I see that was all just essentially wasted. I'm just feeling kind of neutral about it. Just a full stop. Not trying to generate a viewpoint or position on it. Just letting it sink in. It's like saying, I want to know what it feels like to be enlightened on the edge of a cliff. When you're enlightened, there is no cliff. I want to know what it's like to be enlightened when you're sick. When you're enlightened, there is no sickness. I want to know what it's like to be enlightened when I'm dead. When you're enlightened, there is no death. You cannot have an enlightened death. You cannot have an enlightened sickness. You cannot have an enlightened suffering. So this is great. I mean, this is great progress. There's no question about it. This is, you know, a mind blower. Just a wow. The training, the discipline we have here is full stop in the wow. Don't struggle. Full stop in the wow. Don't struggle. This is essential. Mood of repentance. I have a severe continuity problem. I know the way will be slow. Hit the brake. And full stop in the burn. Full stop in the now. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Don't struggle. Full stop in the wow. Don't struggle. So all of this discipline, I'm saying, this is what works. And when you do this, these epiphanies will happen. And then you just keep do your practice. Full stop in the wow. I don't care what the insight is. And this is a colossal insight. Colossal recognition, but still same discipline, no different. Don't struggle with it. Don't form an opinion about it. Don't form a conclusion about it. Don't try to develop a viewpoint. Just sort of a disinterested detachment. Just say, okay, fine, it's here. Don't let the mind wander off. Think about success, don't think about failure. Just maintain sort of a neutral view, neutral sort of full stop in the now, full stop in the wow. Don't try to suppress the wow, don't try to increase it. So this is a kind of mindfulness meditational repentant state of, right, a repentant attitude, a repentant attention. And then these epiphanies will happen because your response is you keep it smooth. There's a sense of continuity, right? Remember, our fear is the continuity fear. And so what we're doing is we're intentionally using our attention to produce a sense of continuity, all right? So when you do this and keep doing it, you can get to an insight like this, and still I'm just generating continuity with this. My actions are, when you're sitting quietly, how can you not have continuity from moment to moment? See, this is the key about sitting quietly like this. It automatically generates a sense of continuity. Sitting still, sitting quiet. So when you have an epiphany like this, you keep sitting still, sitting quietly, and you say, oh, nothing's changed with my actions at all. My actions haven't changed at all. My body is still exactly the way it was before. You say, oh, okay, nice, comfortable sense of continuity. What you don't want to do is you don't want to jump up and scream Eureka and grab your flashlight and go running through the neighborhood shouting everybody, hey, everybody, I know how you can be saved. I know how you can be saved. I've got the answer finally. Hey, you gotta wake up, wake up, wake up. I don't go running around waking up the neighborhood. You just keep sitting silent, quietly, still. Just sit still. So this generates a comfort zone, a mood of continuity, a mood of continuity, an attitude of continuity. You say, yeah, okay, well, my clarity just, like, you know, just it took some quantum leap, but everything else is the same. Same place, I'm just sitting here doing nothing. Not reacting. My reactions are the same. My breath is the same. I feel the same. Everything's the same. Now there's a little burn there, sure. But we're used to that too. You see, so there's continuity here. We're intentionally producing continuity. This is the secret of meditation. Meditators may think they're like being really smart. No. That they're actually generating a sense of continuity, which enables the innate greatness of I am-ness to surface. And then you just continue as you were before. It's the secret of secrets. What you don't want to do is start acting differently. Which is why being committed to doing nothing prevents that. Now, I have a video rendering in there. And let it render. I'm just sitting here. See, it can wait, it can wait. I don't need to be fussing with it. Just sit here quietly. So I say that sitting quietly each day, whether you're reading a book, watching a video, writing poetry or prose, maybe you're writing an exercise to do, or doing an exercise, or just quiet mind contemplation, or maybe taping into your video camera or smartphone. Be committed to it, be committed to it, be committed to it. And the more you do it, then there's an inner confidence that arises you're not even aware of, which enables these tremendous insights to arise, and you're able to handle it like a pro. You keep generating continuity, sense of continuity, feeling of continuity. So I say, even if Jesus shows up in front of you, just keep, stay still. And you say, okay, my actions are the same. My body's in the same place. Everything is familiar. My mind is still just full stopped in the now, full stopped in the wow. So I'm used to that. Okay, full stop in the wow. And so you're generating continuity. You say, hello, Jesus. You're in my dream of continuity here. Welcome to my dream of continuity. And you just stay still. You don't jump up and say, hey, let's sing a song. Let's go evangelize the neighborhood. Oh my gosh, let's go evangelize. Come on. No, just sit still. So virtually everything you're doing is what you're used to doing. So you have continuity right there. And this enables then, this is enabling of recognition. You begin to recognize more and more. Whoops, you say, whoops, I can't have an enlightened sickness. Okay, I can't have an enlightened death. I can't have an enlightened life, actually. I can't be an enlightened. Every one of these is just like complete wow. And yet, just see, sitting here quiet, I see myself. I'm sitting here and nothing's changing. Background is the same. Seat is the same. Flower is the same. Posture is the same. Vocalizing words is the same. Sitting here quietly is the same. So, we now know the secret of the meditation masters. I don't even know if they know it, but we do. We certainly do now. We're generating continuity. And that enables us to look where we haven't looked before, to see where we haven't seen before, to recognize where we haven't recognized before, to accept what we haven't accepted before. Because we say, well, this is a new acceptance, but everything else is the same. So I feel very much a lot of continuity here going forward. It's interesting that the true meditation masters will say, choose a place, and try to make it the same place every day. They don't explain why. I don't know, but they don't, but we know now the secret. Try to make it the same place every day. Why? Because everything is familiar. So even if a very unfamiliar recognition comes into your mind, you'll say, oh, it's okay, come on in. Everything else is very familiar. It's like a guest coming to your home. Everything you're familiar with your home, you don't have any continuity problem. The guest might be very different than you're used to, but you say, oh, everything else in my house is exactly the same. It's no problem. So, secret sitting quiet. Well, now we know why meditators sit in a cave. It's the same cave, isn't it? There's nothing that changes in the cave. I mean, outside, you got the seasons change, the trees look different, the different seasons, the grass, the whole landscape, everything, the weather, everything's changing. Here, in a cave, for instance, there's nothing changing. Longchenpa did most of his meditation, spent a lot of his life simply in a cave. And right now, it's all dark outside. I don't see anything. It's just the light here in the background, that's all I see. It's like being in a cave, actually, to tell you the truth. I never thought about that before, but it's very much like there's no weather I'm aware of, really. You know, it's just like being in a cave. So whatever arises, you say, oh, that's fine, but I'm still exactly where, you know, sitting here in a cave, everything's totally familiar to me. So there's something to be said for a very simple life, meaning get used to everything that you have. I enjoy keeping stuff that for a long time, same utensils, the same bowl, and I'd be, you know, placemat, everything. I like familiarity with what surrounds me. It's a secret of success. If you're constantly changing everything, redecorating, reaccessorizing, shifting how you look, this, and that, then you're losing your advantage. You're throwing away the secret of success. If you're not trying to be successful. If you're not, then maybe you want to every day, you know, I want new stuff, new stuff, new stuff, new stuff. I went through a phase like that just to see what it was like. And certainly I was distracted from the path, absolutely. The question is, was it an intentional distraction or was it distraction in order to set up success later? I'm not sure. But at any rate, it does distract you when you're constantly accessorizing, changing this, changing that. I want a new look. I want new landscaping. I want new this. I want new car. I want new. I want new things. This is why I say a materialistic society is a disaster, spiritual disaster. People are not putting themselves in a situation where they can succeed. That's the problem. So now I'm really seeing it. Why this world is in such bad shape. Almost every story of enlightenment, it seems to be someone very simple, someone sitting in the same place for many years, you know, and then, you know, they awaken. Awakening takes place. Very humble, very simple. You don't see somebody going through a kaleidoscope of materiality and waking up. Which is why I'm such a big advocate for a simple culture, simplicity. Have your little hut. Have your little table, your chair. That's why monasteries, everything's very simple. You get used to that cot and the chair and the walls and the little room and the area. And it doesn't change. It doesn't change. It stays the same for hundreds of years. So you sit down and suddenly something clarifies in your attention. Your attention rests on something. Say, oh my gosh. I don't even need any backstory at all. And this is like so incredible. But here you are sitting quietly in a place that you're completely familiar with. And then you say, oh, I'm glad that I'm in a place I'm really familiar with here. Because this recognition is something that's brand new. And it's just, it's epic. Now, it's not a contrivance. It's not something to be forced. It's just something to be done in your life. Just simple life. See, the tortoise wins the race. The hare is jumping all over the place, saying, into new circumstances, constantly jumping around new circumstances. The tortoise is in his shell. It says, it's always the same here, the tortoise says. It's always the same. I feel very comfortable. I have this continuity. I'm carrying this shell, and I just go into the shell and it's exactly the same shell. I'm very used to it. The hair is jumping all over the place. So, cannot maintain a sense of continuity when insights arise, so insights won't arise. Again, you can't force it. You can't just sit down and stare at a wall. I mean, I remember growing up in... When I grew up, everybody was into meditation. Meditation was a big, big deal. It was like new to the West, kind of. And it was seeping into the West from the East. And we, you know, young people, we were into like, what's the newest thing? And the meditation was like, you're all reading, you know, meditation books. What? And so I tried all sorts of stuff, like, you know, stare at a wall. Okay, I want to be enlightened. So I'm just going to like, concentrate, stare at the wall. Like, you know. We were just trying all sorts of stuff. And we didn't know what we were doing. Nobody could explain, and nobody's ever explained. I've been trying to figure it out my whole life. What is really the secret to it? Now I know. Now I know the whole story to it. It's not about staring at a wall. It's just simply everydayness. Going to the same place every day. and being committed to being quiet and still there. Just a simple commitment, no contrivance. Whatever arises, you're just going to maintain your stillness, quietness, non-reactiveness, full stop in the nowness, full stop in the wowness. That's it. That's it. And simply by doing that every day, you automatically are generating a sense of continuity. And that's the bridge that you're walking across. You're generating a bridge of continuity without trying to mentally, intellectually do anything about it at all. It's just there. Because you know, you can sit quietly for 2 hours like this. You can just sit quietly for 2 hours, no matter what arises. Now, you're not trying to attain to some state of mind. You're simply committed. This is an inner commitment. And your spirit, you know you have this commitment, so that allows insight to arise automatically. You're not trying to attain a state of stillness. You're just committed to spending the time, committed to, whatever arises, it doesn't matter. And you'll find that your life becomes more focused, because you're going to turn things down. Like, hey, you want to come with us and do this? And no, maybe not. Maybe next time. No, not really. Because you realize you're committed. You're committed. Like, today you're going to sit quietly too. And so it's like that. And so you wonder, in the past we're like, this age is so arrogant, full of itself. It doesn't realize that in the past, many, many, many people, many of us woke up. How's that possible? A lot of them were simply, had a pair of sandals and a shawl and just some, like, one fabric they wrap around themselves, and a little fire, a little rice, a little stove, a little fire, a little rice, a little cooking clay pot to cook or something, and little hut, little simple life. Every day they'd meditate for, sit quietly for 4 hours or so, or maybe 8 hours or whatever. And under those circumstances, they would wake up. And I feel that this age doesn't have any understanding of that. That in the past, we were way more, much more enlightenment was taking place. There was a lot of retreats, a lot of monasteries, a lot of places, retreats, and a lot of people engaged in that. And it was all done very simple. Just sit in a cave, Very simple. Simple life is the key. And that's what we're losing today, aren't we? We don't have to live in some retreat. We can do it at our house, our apartment, our place of living, and just have a place where you're not disturbed and just sit there quietly. It could be in a chair in your room. Not trying to attain a state. Not trying to attain some insight. Not trying to attain anything at all. Just a commitment, and just say, this is what is the best, quickest way, for sure. The best and quickest way. It evaporates the continuity fear. Builds a bridge. Meditators of the past, they would tell their students, they'd say, look, just sit quietly and don't anticipate anything, and just they did what their teacher told them, and then experiences would start arising for them because they had the discipline. We're all trying to have these external experiences. Go, 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 go. Hey, I got the new outfit here. I got new clothes. Got some accessories. Let's go to this place. Let's go to this place. This. And we're thinking we're having all these experiences. But by sitting quietly, you end up with the experience like, hey, I don't need to generate a backstory for I am. And then you realize I don't even need to be born. None of this is necessary. See, these are the kind of realizations that one has. And you just sit quietly. Okay, none of this is necessary. Never needed to appear as a body ever, actually. It's all, everything that's happened has been 100% totally unnecessary. No need for it whatsoever. Never will be a need for it. So nobody is bound by any need. Nobody is, no one is bound. No one in the one family is bound by any need whatsoever. None of us. None of us in the one family. We are all, you hear people say we're all one. I say we're all one family. We're all one family, actually. We're all family. One family of perfect love. No one bound by any need whatsoever. No one will ever be bound by any need whatsoever. No need for any backstory whatsoever. As far as I am, I am doesn't need any backstory at all. None. So no one is bound by any need, actually, in the slightest bit. It's all delusion. We've just discovered the secret of meditation. What are we doing? We're sitting quietly. Full stop in the wow of this, that's all. So during this time, we're not eating food. Not eating food. If we need to drink some water, we'll drink some water. That's fine. But no food. So we're not saying, oh, this is different food. I'm not used to this food or anything. No food, just water. So keep everything sparse and simple. Sparse and simple. If you want to succeed. At least have that situation in your life. You don't have to live every second that way, sparse and simple. You can listen to a song, but your life trends in that direction, sparse and simple, sparse and simple. But not trying to show off at all. Keep it unannounced, uncontrived, not as a contrivance. Some say this world is actually very helpful for enlightenment, whereas in the astral realm, everything is so easy to change, 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 change. Here, it can be quite difficult to change, so it's easier to keep it same, 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 same. And by doing that, then you can really, you feel safe to actually realize none of this is needed. No one is bound by any need. Nothing is bound by need. Again, not trying to attain a state. Don't measure success. Not trying to measure success, attain some state. We're just hanging out, hanging loosely, hanging freely, relaxed, in the full stop, in the now. And, from time to time, our attention will feel capable of taking a look at something very, very interesting. No one's bound by any necessity. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? Secret of meditation, generating a bridge of continuity, that's pretty interesting. We can't have an enlightened sickness. That's pretty interesting, you see. Each one of these are incredibly interesting, incredibly compelling. And yet we're just saying, okay, that's nice. Just sit here quietly, and fine. I've been sitting quietly like this for a long time, actually. I remember when I first started, but it was probably... I used to just sit on a bench on a street. Just sit there and watch the people go by. Just sit quietly. Don't say anything. Don't think anything. Just be observant. Just attention. Just. And then I began to notice all sorts of amazing subtlety in human behavior. I just sit like this. Just really quietly. Not going anywhere. Not restless or anything. Just sit quietly. That started in 1978, actually, when I started reading A Course in Miracles. I just sit in a chair and read it and then set the book down and just keep sitting in the chair. And it's very interesting, actually. It started before that because I got very ill. And I was so tired I couldn't do nothing but sit in a chair. And so I'd end up just reading in a chair and just, so really most of my life I've just been like sitting in quietly in a chair. I didn't realize how helpful that is actually. If you're sitting in a chair reading a book, not moving for 6 to 8 hours at a time. I used to do that, you know, day after day, all day long, just sit in a chair. I was so fatigued. It was very difficult to even get out of a chair. I could do it, but I was exhausted. So I'll just sit in a chair for 14 hours a day, read A Course in Miracles, read spiritual books. And then I'd read for a while, and I'd set them down. I'd just sit here like this, like that, not looking at anything in particular, just remaining still. So I guess I've been doing it most of my life. Not really as a contrivance, just it's just what happened. Mostly starting out because I got so sick when I was young, which has turned out to be a blessing in disguise in some way. Wasn't able to pursue a life of activity, so I had to follow a life of sitting in a chair quietly. And by doing that, I began to gain insight into the teaching, you see. I began to make progress. The more progress I made, the more I said, hey, maybe I might be able to have some success at this, you know. Maybe I can get somewhere. Maybe this, who knows, I don't know, but let's see. And so, I had a feeling this life I would wake up. So I just said, well, I'm really going to try to do everything I can. But I didn't realize that sitting, you know, sitting in a chair was so helpful, sitting quietly. I said, I should be out proselytizing. I should be out doing this, 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 this. I can't do any of that stuff. How can I possibly succeed? Everybody else is going around attending seminars and conferences, and they're so busy, and they're talking to everybody and networking. And here I am just sitting like this, like a stone in a chair. I was like, wow, I'm really falling behind. Terrible. But Jesus always said, don't worry about that. Forget it, forget it, forget it. Just go faster, you know, faster. Just do it more hours, and just don't worry about what other people are doing. Don't even think about it. So gradually, I train myself not even think about it. What other people are doing, just not even my attention doesn't even go there really. Mind needs to be quiet too. So it's not like you want to be watching some action, adventure, horror movie or something while I'm sitting quietly, I'm watching this horror movie. No. Because we want our mind, we want to notice when insights arise. We want to be still and full stop right there. So sort of like a diffuse, your senses should be diffuse. You're not really sharp on anything. You're not trying to be blurry, you're not trying to be sharp. I know some people say with bad eyesight, all they have to do is take their glasses off and they can't see anything anyway, which is true. And that might actually help you somewhat in meditating, because you can't focus on anything anyway. But that's a contrivance in my opinion. So it's better just to hang loosely, you know, with your senses, with not trying to be sharp about anything, and then just then study a book, read a book, consider spiritual teachings, and you may have an epiphany, and then just stop, full stop. Don't struggle with it, don't do anything with it, don't try, don't fixate, don't scheme, don't plan. Don't analyze. Don't practice. Don't meditate on it. Don't, you know, all this. No contrivances here. Just let it be. Let it be. Just continue to be. Be quiet. But not as a contrivance. Don't go into a trance. Don't go into a trance state. Don't try to go into any trance state. Don't be attacking anything. Don't be suppressing. Just be committed. Just be committed to sitting in familiar surroundings like this quietly and focusing on spiritual truth. I am doesn't need a backstory. Doesn't need a forward story. Doesn't need a backstory. So you may be having incredible progress, and yet, you know, you feel calm, relaxed, calm. In other words, familiar territory. You're not all hyper, not all nervous, unglued. You can have a burn, but there you just full stop in the burn. You don't react to it. So even that, you still feel comfortable, familiar. gotten sick, for sure. I would have pursued a more active life, absolutely. This put severe restrictions. And even now I have severe restrictions. No money. Okay, so even if I can go somewhere and do stuff now, I can't do it because I don't have any money. So I have to just sit here quietly like this. So, it's been a big help. It's been a big help. Blessed are the poor. Yeah, the poor sit in a chair in their room for 30 years, not being able to really do much of anything in the world. Ah, and when they realize, I can't have an enlightened life. I either have enlightenment or an unenlightened life. There's no such thing as an enlightened life. I can't have an enlightened sickness. I cannot have an enlightened death. I cannot have... Say, okay, that's fine. I see that. This calm. So I can't have enlightened karma. I cannot have enlightened karma. You can't have your karma and eat it too. You can't have your karma and be enlightened too. You see, you can't have your death and be enlightened too. Can't have your cake and eat it too. Cannot. So if you've done a lot of just sitting in your life, quiet sitting, there's very good possibility that you're quite advanced on the spiritual path, actually. And that you're used to generating continuity. That's why you're making so much progress. Now, you may not see yourself that way, which is fine, because you're committed to the full stop, which is fine. But don't sell yourself short in terms of, don't give up, because you're probably really, really moving, or not moving, you're really evaporating the continuity fear. I talked to a lady meditator, very advanced, and she said the same thing. She got sick when she was really young. I was like, what was it, some sort of, she couldn't move or something? And she spent all her time just sitting, reading books and just sitting, and couldn't have an active life, couldn't do, she had almost a polio, no, some kind of paralysis or some epilepsy, severe epilepsy, and she was just, you know, an invalid for most of her life. She was an invalid. And so, and she ended up teaching meditation, actually. She met a spiritual master, and so, you see, and she thought, we both thought, you know, this was beneficial for a spiritual path. I wonder if autistic people actually aren't very spiritual people who prefer to sit quietly like this, you know, sit quietly. I always wanted to get away from people and just be by myself. Just go somewhere and just sit. And so it could be the autistic people, if you just let them meditate, let them sit, they may end up being spiritual masters or are awakened, you know. We keep trying to socialize them, give them medication, medicate. People feel so sad. Oh, I have an autistic child. Oh my gosh, you know. Yeah, maybe you have a great meditator in your family. People are saying, what causes it? We must stop this. It's terrible. Maybe it's their spirit. Their spirit brought it about. Her spirit said, I don't want to waste another lifetime. I want to sit quietly. And I'm a poster child for that, for sitting quietly in your life. And then you get to the point where you realize you don't need any karma. You don't need any backstory. You don't need to remember what your backstory was. You don't need any at all. So just let go of it all. Let go of everybody's backstory. Nobody needs a backstory. Often as the children who are sick, invalids, etc., they're the ones who are most spiritual. They do it on purpose. Their spirit says, we're going to use this backstory like this, so you can finally realize you don't need any backstory at all. So a little bit of suffering is worth it, you know, or maybe a lot of suffering, but it's still worth it to realize nobody needs a backstory at all. Reality has no needs. No one's bound by any needs. It's not just me, it's everyone. So you see, the one family will never be separated. See, this is the vision of oneness, is realization that this one family, which is, we are members of this one family. This is very important to realize that we belong in this one family. We are family members. Just one family. There's only one family, and we're in that family. Talk about a great tribe, you know. The only tribe there is, and we're it. And nobody will ever be separated out from it. This is the vision of oneness. This is what I saw. Now, I've never read that this is the realization that people have, but this is what I had. This is what I saw. This is what I felt. This is what I knew. And this is what gave me this tremendous elation. And tremendous relief. This is what we actually want to see and to know. No separation, no, but we'll never lose, any one of us will never be lost to the family, ever. No one. And when you see this, I'm telling you, it's just like almost overwhelming happiness. But even when you see this, you know, sit quietly. Because everything that's happening we see in this dream of bodies is just a backstory. None of it has the slightest relevance to reality whatsoever. It's all much ado about nothing. Much ado about nothing. Doesn't separate, bring about any separation whatsoever. Doesn't bring about any need whatsoever. There is no need to finish a story. Finish your story. There's no need to start a story. There's no need to finish a story. There's no need to continue it. There's no need to not continue it. There simply is no need at all. So there's no need to start it. There's no need to not start it. No need to finish it. No need to not finish it. No need to continue it. No need to not continue it. It's like that. Now, meditators often wear like a meditation shawl. So they look the same every time. Everything, you know, is the same. You see the Buddhists, you know, wearing the same, the robes or their outfits, the color, the ochre, and, you know, the saffron ochre color. You know, they look the same. Their hair is like shaved. They look the same. Every day they look the same. So continuity, 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 continuity. And it really works. It really, 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 really works. Many are repentant and saying, you know, I'm tired of this backstory. It's really, I've had it. How do I get free of this backstory? They'll be, you know, we'll be able to set up institutions, be able to, and it's very simple. and be able to use the secret of success, which is generating continuity within your life. And then the insights and clarity will arise for those who do that. It's very simple. Again, not a contrivance. We're not attached to, you know, what we're doing, how we look, and all this stuff. We simply understand it's a necessity because of our continuity fear. It's not that our spirit is going to be like this always, our attention, but it's necessary. It's a treatment. It's like a necessary treatment, necessary medicine to take. And when you see the benefits of it, you say, oh, it's worth it. When I realize no one is bound by need. No one will ever be bound by need. The one family is perfectly safe. I need not fear at all that our love could be compromised in the slightest bit. And then you just feel perfect and whole, you know, and just joyful. And released from your concern. I remember stories of like yogis and was it Lahiri Mahasaya, that's his name, and it might be a little bit off, but he's meditating, where he's meditated for years and years and years and years and years, doing his usual meditation in the same room, same mat, you know, same, everything's the same every day. It's been the same for maybe decades there. And some master, Babaji, or some master appears in his room. Happened, I guess, Sri Yukteswar, Lahiri Mahasaya, appeared to Sri Yukteswar as he was meditating. And, you know, he says, well, that's okay, because I'm in my room, I'm in my meditation room. I'm completely comfortable here. I'm completely full stopped in the now. I'm just so... sure, okay. If my teacher wants to appear to me as light, fine. It's not a problem. So all sorts of seemingly miraculous situations can occur when you're able to truly have this continuity bridge, portable continuity bridge with you, plank, that portable plank, stand a plank, and wherever you go, you can bridge. You can bridge to all sorts of situations, but you know, best of all is the recognitions, the insights. I've never had any of these miraculous thing appearances of gurus and teachers and manifestation. I've never had anything like that. That, you know, I think like an autobiography of a yogi by Paramahamsa or Yogananda. Never had anything like that take place. But I have had these recognitions like, oh, nobody needs any backstory at all. Oh, I would say that's more important than having Babaji show up, you know? Because it's total all-inclusive, isn't it? It's totally generalized to no one needs. No backstory is needed whatsoever, period. No place, never. I am requires no backstory in any way, so no one can ever take on that need, that responsibility. It's totally unnecessary. So nobody's bound by their karma at all. They're not bound by their story at all. They're not bound by their backstory at all. Never will be. Never have been, and never will be in the slightest bit. Everyone is free right now. Everyone has always been free, always will be free. The one family is one family. It's undivided. It's seamless. One family is absolutely seamless, completely unbound, completely free. The one family of freedom remains absolutely free this very moment and each moment and each moment. No exceptions. No exceptions. So, it's interesting that not getting all these bells and whistles, spiritual bells and whistles, you know, it probably is helpful. It's probably as helpful because that could easily turn into some sort of glamour. You know, I just have not had anything glamorous happen to me. You know, I've had contacts and dreams, subtle contact, but, you know, that's why I was asleep. And it doesn't really feel glamorous at all, anything. They never show up again, you know. It's just not very glamorous at all, really. You know, I have never heard voices, you know, no channeling, no walking somewhere and I see a spiritual master, like in Mount Shasta or something. Nothing's ever happened. But I do see no one needs any backstory, no one needs any karma. The one family is totally, inherently, greatly cohesive and one. And everybody is totally included in it. It is absolute inclusion. The one family is perfect inclusion, and we're all included in it. I do see that, you see. So, maybe if I saw a teacher somewhere, I'd spend my life writing a book about it when I saw a guru. And, you know, go around telling everybody, giving lectures on, yes, I met this guru, and it was wonderful, and I had a great experience, and it was very enlightening, I felt, well, you know, but I can't do that. You can't even write a book, and no one's, you know, no teacher's ever said, hey, would you write a book for me, or do anything? No, nothing. So all I can do is sit here quietly and focus in on clarity, that's it. And interestingly enough, everyone that I'm seems to be everyone that is watching these videos, and they're not really interested in any of that stuff either, very much, right? It just doesn't seem to be interesting at all. That's good. Very, very great. Is the people who are depressed and sitting there like that, they're actually, you know, those are the ones who actually are on the fast track. Autistic, depressed, invalid, sick, whatever. And they're sitting quietly. They've been sitting quietly for, you know, 10 years, 20 years. Studying, listening carefully. That's the fast track. No gurus, no teachers, nothing's happened. No lights, no, you know, nothing to fixate on. Nothing to fixate on has happened. Great. Fast track. So don't fixate on anything. Don't fixate on these insights. Don't fixate on the insights. Just let them arise, and, okay? Don't need that as a backstory. I don't need to develop a backstory about, there's no backstory. Now, what's the great Zen master? Dog Chen or something? Dogen? Dogen or Dogen? He said that just sitting Zazen, that is the practice, that is, you know, he said some things about this is enlightenment or sitting quietly or something. Well, yeah, sitting quietly, but not as a contrivance. There's nothing wrong with being active, your mind considering truth and looking at it, etc. In fact, I think that's a great thing, because that brings up the burn. It's like, whoa, I just had a huge breakthrough. And then there's sitting quietly is a reason for it. Now, it's possible that just sitting quietly, for the sake of sitting quietly, can develop such a state of continuity within you that it may perhaps, realization can take place. And certainly the testimony of the ages is that can and does happen. But this mindfulness like this too is the same principle at work. It's possible to you know, the meditation teachers, they should know what they're doing, so I don't need to tell them what their business is. But this here is certainly very, very compelling what we're doing here. It's called active meditation in some ways, somewhat active. Not trying to attain a state. Not trying to attain alignment. Not trying to attain, a breakthrough or anything like that. We're just hanging loosely, relaxed in the now. So full stopped in the now, just hanging out and taking a look at what arises. And it's very profound. What arises is tremendously profound. The one tribe is all inclusive. And when this dawns on us, it's tremendous. There's no way anyone can leave it. See, we're not so concerned about us leaving it. We're concerned someone else might. No one can leave it. Despite all appearances of the contrary. And when we really get that, then our fears are gone. Our worries and concerns and fears, our spiritual worries, are gone. Finished. So everything here is just a backstory we're all working on, imagining, as if it were necessary. And that if we don't do it right, we won't be included, you see. Our inclusiveness is not yet established. We need a backstory to establish what we are. That is not true. It is absolutely not true. So, we don't struggle with it. We do our best. Breakthroughs didn't come at any moment. You don't know. You just see something. You're at a stoplight, and you look at the truck next to you, and there's something on the side of the truck, and you just say, that's it. Just boom. Got it. So you don't have to have breakthroughs as you sit quietly. You don't have to. It's the discipline. It's the continuity. It's you know you can do it. You're doing it every day. You got confidence in yourself. So it's super important. Super, super important. It's the secret of success. All right. So we will not struggle. We will not try to make some ultimate breakthrough here. And very great. That's it for the video.